Exmoor National Park is a special place. Its beautiful and varied landscape is recognised as one of the finest in Britain. But the Exmoor you'll see today is a product of a rich and fascinating history that made it the way it is now. And if you look closely, you'll see evidence of this, from recent transformations to changes brought about over thousands of years, and ultimately, to the very formation of the continents 200 million years ago. Our story starts with a single vast continent called Pangaea. While dinosaurs still roamed the land, earth-shattering forces gradually broke up this landmass and started to create the continental shapes we know today. If you take a walk on the beach at Coombe Martin, you can still see evidence of these upheavals. These lines in the rocks are layers of ancient bedrock formed around 400 million years ago. But here they are today, split, broken, torn apart by those huge forces millions of years ago. A gentler effect was the crumpling of the land. Again, movement of the different sections of the Earth's crust was the cause. These contours, further eroded by water, are evident in the many valleys or coombes which are characteristic of Exmoor and have given their names to towns and villages all over the region. Ten thousand years ago, the last ice age was nearing its end. But Exmoor was still a cold land that belonged to species such as woolly mammoths, saber-toothed tigers, and ancient horses. The hardy but beautiful Exmoor ponies that you see today would have looked very much like them. Small numbers of our ancestors would have been here too, in the occasional warmer phases that man would venture this far north. With so much water locked up in the ice caps, the sea level would have been very much lower. Stone Age man would have been able to hunt across the Bristol Channel, which would have been mainly dry land. By the end of the Ice Age, there had been a huge rise in sea levels, flooding the channel and sending the animals and our ancestors up onto the higher ground. Here in Porlock Bay, at low tide, the mysterious stumps of alder and oak emerge like ghosts of an ancient past, clear evidence of forests that once covered what's now the seabed. Pieces of flint have been found around Exmoor too, dating back to this time. Our hunter ancestors would have had a wide diet. Nuts, plants, berries and seafood, but animal meat would also have been an important food source, and the skins and fat from animals valuable to winter survival. Around 5,000 years ago, our hunter ancestors began to change their lifestyle, forming small settlements and managing the land around them. They also made their mark on the land in stone. There are many stone rows, stone circles and stone settings all over Exmoor, which are thought to date from the end of the Neolithic period, around 4,000 years ago. The largest and most striking is the Long Stone. At 9 foot high, this single stone dominates the landscape. We do know these stones were put there by our ancestors, but to this day, we still don't know exactly why. You can also find barrows and cairns used for human burial nearly everywhere on Exmoor. There are almost 400 of them. You can walk among them and imagine what you might have seen around you 4,000 years ago. In around 750 BC, ironworking techniques reached Britain. Their introduction would revolutionize many aspects of life, most importantly agriculture. And there is evidence on Exmoor of ironworkings dating back to this time. you can also see evidence of defended settlements from the Iron Age. This is what Bat's Castle might have looked like. It's just south of Dunster. And this is Bury Castle, north of Selworthy. The type and location of their construction suggests small-scale societies that were in contact and in conflict with their neighbours. Then a new society arrived in Britain, whose art, technology and language would have totally surpassed anything our ancestors on Exmoor had ever experienced. It must have been like meeting beings from outer space. The Romans arrived in Britain in AD 43, and in the following years set up a major fortress in Exeter, supported by a network of smaller forts and garrisons, such as this extremely well-preserved fortlet at Aldborough. The fortlet overlooks the sea and the south coast of Wales, which was unconquered at the time. You can still clearly see the outer ridge, which would have been for defences, and a smaller, rectangular inner, which would have been an enclosed area. Excavations here have revealed posts, which suggest that this was a tented camp, used only for a few years. There is also evidence that iron production on Exmoor reached a huge scale at this time. While this seam at Berkham was exploited well into the 19th century, creating this massive openwork, mining here is believed to date back to the Romans and before. The Romans more or less left Britain to govern itself as their focus turned to threats elsewhere. Then enter the Saxons, who left their name in the towns and villages of Exmoor. The Tun of Dulverton and place names ending in Cot, Ham and Worthy are all Anglo-Saxon words relating to hamlets or farms. If you visit the church at Porlock, itself dating back to the 13th century, you can see remnants of an ancient cross, which in Anglo-Saxon times would have stood outside. We don't truly know an awful lot about the early medieval period. One reason it's known, a little misleadingly, as the Dark Ages. But we do know that a substantial part of Exmoor was designated as royal forest for the Anglo-Saxon kings, and that, to the local people, would have meant jobs and money. Then, in 1066, came the Norman Conquest, which would result in new landowners and a new and rather harsh system of forest law and administration. If you visit the church in the village of Paracombe, you'll be treated to a view across the valley of what is one of the best preserved early Norman castle sites anywhere in the UK. Even today, you can clearly see the shape of its Mott and Bailey construction. But perhaps the most significant contribution of the new Norman rulers was something totally different. The Great Survey, by order of King William the Conqueror, was completed in 1086 and recorded in the Domesday Book, a remarkable document that gives us huge detail of the whole country, including Exmoor at that time. Dulverton is recorded as already being quite a large town, having 25 villages, 6 smallholders, and 6 slaves. Dunster, a little smaller, with just 15 households. And another village called Badgery, recorded as small, with 2 households, but with 24 sheep, other animals, and 30 acres of pasture, so already a busy farm. Today, Dunster Castle, originally a Norman fort, dominates a main street that still retains the shape of the original borough town. Excavation here behind the Luttrell Arms in 2016 revealed long, thin plots behind the expensive shop frontages, much as you would find today. The Royal Forest took on increasing importance for hunting and for grazing animals, said to number 43,000 by the early 1600s. The wool trade became a key contributor to local income, and in Dunster, you can also see the wonderfully preserved yarn market. It's interesting to see how the pattern of farms and villages recorded almost 1,000 years ago so closely resembles that of today, with some notable exceptions. Cross the bridge at Malmesmead and you'll find signs to Badgery Valley. Badgery, just as Dunster, was recorded in the Domesday Book as a growing village. But here is Badgery today. Perhaps some local plague or other catastrophe caused it to be abandoned, or perhaps it was simply that better wages could be found elsewhere. Throughout the ages, life on Exmoor for many was a struggle against the elements. Then, in the 1700s, as an appreciation of art and literature gathered pace, the great poets and painters of the day took an interest too. It was here that Samuel Taylor Coleridge found the inspiration to write The Rime of the Ancient Mariner, and William Wordsworth described Valley of Rocks as a beautiful work of nature's art. But most of all, Coleridge and his friend Wordsworth would walk and enjoy the sights and sounds of Exmoor, particularly around Porlock and Culbone Woods. And today, with the Coleridge Way extended from Porlock to Lynmouth, you too can follow in the footsteps of the Romantic poets. In the early 1800s, John Knight, a wealthy man from Worcestershire, already an accomplished agriculturalist, went about buying practically all of the old Royal Forest. His plan was to turn Exmoor into a single estate. He commissioned a system of banks and hedges, hundreds of miles of them, which stand to this day. He created a reservoir, Pinkery Pond, to generate his water supply. And he had a sawmill built at Simmonsbath, designed to supply cut wood for his estate. Then, in 1837, just 17 years after he moved here, John Knight and most of his family left. No one is exactly sure why, but his line and his vision was continued and developed by one of his sons, Frederick. But in the end, the grand plan simply couldn't be sustained. Even the great mansion in Simmonsbath was never completed and now forms part of the hotel. But while he never succeeded in his grand plan, the landscape of Exmoor will bear the mark of John Knight and his family far into our future. Built on local folklore and loosely based on a real set of characters, the novel Lorna Doone, written by Richard Doddridge Blackmore in 1869, captured the imagination of the nation. The East Lynne Valley became Doone Valley. Orr Church and other locations featured in the book, and Badgery became a cherished site that everyone wanted to visit. Since 1870, the book has never been out of print, and still today the area is known as Doone Country, and the valley remains a hugely popular place to visit and explore. Since the Knight's improvements in the 1800s, it's been a gradual process of slow modernization to this very day. Apart from one significant episode, when Exmoor was touched, like pretty much everywhere, by two world wars. Large parts of Exmoor became a training ground, particularly for tank regiments. And up on North Hill, you'll still find hard standings where the armed vehicles were parked and inspected. These woods were filled with accommodation huts for personnel, although only some rather curious stone steps remain. You can also see one of the first ever radar stations, groundbreaking technology at the time, positioned to look out over the coast. Some of Exmoor's most ancient and precious history was spared, marked as sites of special interest and not to be fired on. But the farms of Exmoor didn't escape completely. Even the very last cottage ever built on the site of medieval badgery turned to rubble. And that is how you'll find it today. Exmoor is a unique and diverse landscape, rich in history, wildlife, and the occasional surprise. And as you explore everything that Exmoor has to offer, it might be even more rewarding to scratch the surface just a little deeper and understand how what you see today has actually been shaped by nature and by people over many thousands of years.